My next guest literally wrote the book on gratitude. Professor Jeffrey Froh of Hofstra University has spent so much time studying thankfulness and its link to happiness, kindness, and well-being that he authored Making Grateful Kids, The Science of Building Character. In his opinion, a thankful heart is a miracle cure for some of life's most difficult challenges. How do we tap into that wonderful drug, as he calls it, and pass it on to our children? Here to tell us about it is Dr. Froh himself. Professor, welcome to Pray, Vote, Stand.
Thank you for having me.
Let me just start with this question, Professor. Do we have a crisis of Thanksgiving in this country? Do we lack gratitude?
Well, I think one of the things that you were talking about is the importance of slowing down, acknowledging the goodness that is in our life amidst all the chaos, and then recognizing that the source of that goodness is largely outside of ourselves, but in terms of a faith perspective, it's entirely out of ourselves, because everything is dependent on God in that way. So I think with all the crises going on, coupled with, you know, how fast things are going, it's very, very difficult for us to recognize all the goodness we have going on. So do we have a crisis of ingratitude? I think we could all use a reminder to slow down and be grateful.
Now, you've taught psychology for a long time. You've counseled both children and adults. But let me ask you this question. What piqued your interest on this whole idea of gratitude and its importance?
So prior to coming to Hofstra, I was a school psychologist. And there was one particular boy who I really connected with. He was in sixth grade, so he was about 11 years old. And he lived in a home that was financially very, very poor. He had to travel very, very far to get to this particular school because it had the program that he needed. And I remember walking down the hallway, and from afar, I heard him call out to me. He was like, "Dr. Froh, Dr. Froh." And I'm looking around, can't quite see who it is. And all of a sudden, I see him in this sea of students with this huge, huge smile on his face. So I go over to him and I said, "Hey, what's going on?" And he said, "Look at this jacket that Mrs. Colligan had given me. Isn't this great?" And when you look at the jacket, it was an oversized sport jacket for an adult. And in this sea of kids who were largely wearing designer clothes, here it was, this young man standing in this hallway wearing an old, ratty, almost sport jacket. And he was so unbelievably ecstatic because his family could not afford a jacket for him as the temperatures got colder. So in that moment, I kind of had this realization. I said, this is absolutely amazing. When you look at all of the struggles and the stresses and strains that this young kid has, and he can stand here in this hallway around people with, you know, quote unquote, more, and he's got this incredibly grateful heart. I said, you know what? I think this is something that we have to look into. So at that point, that's when I started researching gratitude in kids. And unbeknownst to me at the time, no one was doing that. The only study in terms of the psychology of gratitude was back in 2004. And I had this realization in about 05, 06. And they found a correlation between gratitude and life satisfaction. But prior to that, the only thing that was being studied with gratitude in children anyway, was in the 70s in linguistics. And they were just trying to see to what degree do kids say the words thank you as a politeness routine. So that one young man's instance with me in the hallway is really kind of what sparked me. And I said, we got to look into this. There's something here.
So Dr. Froh, was the Apostle Paul onto something when he told us to be grateful in all circumstances?
100%. So one of the biggest misconceptions I think people have is that they think gratitude should only or largely be used in times of good. And it's like, yes, it should, but largely only 100%. No, if anything, it goes exactly to what St. Paul is saying, which is it's when times are so unbelievably difficult, as they are, as they will be, because life is life, that's when you really have to crank it up and you have to do your best to scan your environment and take in the blessings that continue to abound, though life is hard. And as I said earlier, acknowledge the transcendent source, that God is the supreme benefactor, the divine giver of life. And then and then we'll put ourselves in a better place. So only in times of good? Absolutely not. St. Paul nailed it as far as I'm concerned.
Well, in your book, you compare the attitude of Thanksgiving to a wonder drug. Not that you're pushing drugs, but you are pushing Thanksgiving. This is available to everyone, and it has no ill side effects. So it's not just that God says be thankful, have a grateful heart, but there are physiological benefits to gratitude.
It's absolutely tremendous. That's exactly right. So one of the things I love about it is what you're saying. It's free. It's free. You can have it whenever you want. You're just going to have to work for it. So when you look at the 24 character strengths that have been created, gratitude being one of them, of those 24, gratitude has the strongest relation to happiness and life satisfaction. So number one, that's obviously a really cool fun fact, that this is insanely powerful, like over the top powerful. The other beautiful thing coupled with that is that it's the most malleable. So anyone under any circumstance, you can create it. You can cultivate a grateful heart with a conscious effort. Difficult? Totally. Incredibly difficult, especially as we started off with the show, the backdrop of the chaos that we live in right now. So to answer your question specifically in terms of the physiological effects, it obviously reduces our stress hormone, cortisol. We know that cortisol is related with a host of negative outcomes, one of which is inflammation, which they are now linking to all sorts of physical ailments, such as arthritis and things of that sort. It also is related with more cohesive heart patterns or heart rhythms. So it actually lets our heart operate and beat in a more rhythmic, controlled, calm manner. So it keeps us nice and calm. And by the way, when we are very calm, it opens our mind to literally take more in of our world, which, by the way, will help us to continue to see the blessings that abound because we are more open to seeing what exactly that's going on in our lives.
Wow, that's powerful. So it just kind of, Thanksgiving, our gratitude just begins to snowball. And you see that in people that, are grateful. It blossoms and blooms. Let me ask you this question. All right, with this backdrop, and before we run out of time, I want to unpack that. In your research, in all that you've done, and following hundreds of people in your studies, give our viewers, given where we are right now, practical steps of how we can begin to cultivate a heart of gratitude, but more importantly, even begin to instill it in our children and grandchildren.
Okay, so first, very, very practical would be this, okay? So a professor, Alex Wood, some years ago asked a very simple question. Why do grateful people feel grateful? So basic, we had no idea about 10 years ago, okay? The answer is this. We process beneficial exchanges, AKA kind acts when someone's kind to us, very differently in terms of when we're dispositionally or trait-like grateful. And the way we do it is this. There are three factors to this. Cost, intent, and benefit. Okay, so if someone does something kind for you, cost. Do you recognize what this person gave up? What kind of resources, time, energy? It doesn't have to be money, but it could be a part of it, that sort of thing. So what did it cost this person being kind to me, okay? Number two, intent. This person deliberately did something kind for me. They had my best interest in mind. They did not have to do this. They could do whatever they want. They decided to be kind to you. Finally, benefit. To what degree did you benefit from this person's kindness? Okay, so the first is if you can kind of have this more grateful mental filter, if you want to call it that, the more grateful you're going to feel. And this can easily be applied to God as well in terms of cost, intent, benefit. I mean, look at the goodness that he continues to provide no matter how much we sin. He's always there. He's always forgiving us. How amazing is that? So we can kind of think about it like that, I think is beneficial. I would also suggest you can use that thinking, cost, intent, benefit, in writing thank you cards, let's say, right? So 'tis the season to tell people that we're grateful to them, Thanksgiving, Christmas. Cost, intent, benefit, use that to structure your thank you cards and your letters to people instead of just thank you so much for the red sweater, I really appreciate it. Like really, really think about this. So in terms of doing this for your children, let's just go real basic on this one. This is not fancy, do it. Do it yourself. Let them see this. Bring them into your world. So when you are, let's say, writing that thank you letter with cost and intent benefit, Have your kids sitting down next to you. Read it to them. Have them read it. Have a conversation. When they're sending these letters, let's say, to family and friends, say, hey, hon, cost intent benefit. How would you structure your letter? Basic stuff. Again, I have so much to say about this, but those would be kind of like my two, you know, initials.
Does gratitude have the ability, if we really were to focus on this, and again, you made reference to the beginning of the program, how we laid out the reality of the world in which we live, a very divided nation. Could gratitude be something that could once again bring our nation together?
Without question, and this is why I think. So in my latest book that came out 2 weeks ago, it's called Thrive, 10 Commandments for 20-somethings to Live the Best Life Possible, whereby I created these 10 commandments to thrive, and I mapped them onto God's 10 commandments. Commandment 9 is thou shalt give thanks. Commandment 10 is thou shalt master mission. Master the mission given to you by God. Well, why is give thanks right before master mission, right? It's all sequential, it's all systematic. The reason is this: when you recognize that life is a divine gift, that we're not even supposed to be having a conversation right now. I mean, just think about that. That is the craziest thing to me, right? And I'm also well aware that when I leave work today, I may not make it home. I may never see my family again. And that doesn't make me live life in fear of, oh no, this could be it. It's like, no. Walking the line between this is a gift, I do not deserve this, this is unearned, undeserved, and we could die at any moment kind of thing. So when you recognize that life is a divine gift freely given to you by God that you did not earn, you use that energy to discover and master your mission, what you're supposed to be doing with your life, what you must do with your life, not what you want to do with your life. So if we could all do a little bit better with that, that life is a divine gift, you do not deserve this, God loves you, he loved you into existence, to use that what you're supposed to do with your life, guess what? There's gonna be people doing a lot of really, really wonderful things out there that are gonna benefit each other. So if we go like that, in my opinion, I think some things can turn around.
That's powerful stuff. Dr. Froh, I wanna thank you for joining us. I could continue this conversation all evening, but in fact, I'm gonna give you a call back because I wanna talk to you about your book. Maybe we'll get you on Washington Watch to talk about the book. But for now, we're gonna have to end our time together tonight, and I wanna thank you so much for joining us. Very grateful that you were with us tonight.
Thank you so much, I loved it.